Good morning. Welcome to another session of cryptography, network security, and cyber law. Today it is session 2 of module 3. In the previous session, that is session 1 of module 3, we started our discussion on key management, wherein we have defined what we mean by key management, and also we have discussed X.509 certificates. Now in today's session, we will discuss on public key infrastructure, the various functions involved in public key infrastructure, and also the four architectures of public key infrastructures, and also we will discuss on the scenarios that lead to certificate revocation and how certificate revocation can be handled. At the end of the session, you shall be able to brief on the functions of public key infrastructure and describe the public key infrastructure architectures. Along with that, you will be able to explain the certificate revocation methods. Now, let's begin our discussion on public key infrastructure. Now, why we are discussing this public key infrastructure? Because key management is a process in which we are generating the keys, storing the keys, distributing the keys, and also we are updating the keys. Now, what do we mean by key management? Over here, in case of asymmetric cryptography, we have public-private key pairs. These public keys need to be made available to all the other communicating authentic entities. Now, these communicating parties use this particular public key in order to perform functions like encryption, decryption, signature generation, and so on. Now, the question that arises over here is, if an organization wants to use public key or public private key or asymmetric key cryptography, in that case, what are the components that they need? What is the infrastructure required by them? Now, over here in this session, we will see what are the various components involved in public key infrastructure. Now, the first thing that we will see over here is public key infrastructure includes certificate authority. A certificate authority is an entity which is responsible for issuing of certificates which carries the public key to the communicating parties. And also, public key infrastructure includes physical infrastructure such as encryption technologies, that is, technologies required for encrypting and decrypting the plain text to ciphertext and vice versa. And also, physical infrastructure includes the hardware required to enable these encryption technologies. Now, the third thing that is included in the public key infrastructure is the various services required to support digital signatures. Now, let's move on with seeing the services that are provided by public key infrastructure. The services provided by public key infrastructures includes creation of certificate, and once these certificates are created, they are issued to the communicating parties. Now, after they are issued, they need to be stored so that they can be archived and used later when a need arises. We'll see a situation wherein there could be a need for archival. The second service provided by public key infrastructure is the key generation and key escrow. Now, key generation is generation of keys. It could be generation of a public private key pair or a secret key or any set of keys generated. And we will see what we mean by key escrow. Key escrow is an arrangement in which cryptographic keys needed to decrypt certain data are held as and stored as backup. Now, why do we need to back up the keys? These keys need to be retrieved in case of a disaster or a security breach so that the system still functions normal. Now the next service provided by public key infrastructure is certificate and key updation. Now key updation is performed if necessary. The third one is certificate revocation. Now what do we mean by certificate revocation? Now every certificate that is issued has a validity period. We have seen in X.509 certificate format that we have a start date and the end date, which describes or which tells us the validity of the certificate that is issued. Now certificate revocation refers to a process in which the certificate is stated as invalid even before it expires. Now moving further, we will see why a backup is needed and when a backup is not needed. When private keys are used for achieve confidentiality, in such a case a backup is required for decryption keys. Now the question that arises is why? Why do we need to backup a decryption key? Now let's say there are two communicating parties who are communicating sensitive information. The sender encrypts the information with a key, but the receiver who has to decrypt the information has lost the key. In such a situation, the receiver will never be able to decrypt the message. Now, what an organization does in such a scenario is, it stores all the private keys or takes a backup of all the private keys present, of all the employers present in the organization. Now, this process of holding the private keys of all the employers in an organization and it is made available to the employer or the owner in special condition, we call this entire process as key escrow. Okay, key escrow is a process in which the organization is holding all the private keys and taking a backup of all those private keys securely. If in case there is a situation wherein an employer loses his private key, this organization can help him, or this process can help him retrieve the private key and continue with the decryption. Now let's see when we should not back up a private key. A private key should not be backed up if it is used for signing. Now the question is, what if even in this case the private key is lost? Now if a private key is lost which is used for signing, in that case the owner or the employer should inform the certificate authority. The certificate authority is responsible for getting fresh signing certificates and also signing keys and also a new certificate corresponding to the public key. Another important function of the public key infrastructure, other than taking a backup or not taking a backup, is to have a safe archival facility to all the certificates that are issued. Now, when private keys are used for signing, we do not take a backup. But the requirement in case of public key infrastructure is a safe archival facility for all the certificates that are issued. Now the question that arises over here again is, why do we need to have a safe archival facility? Now let's assume that Alice has signed a will which needs to be verified, let's say after 30-40 years after the will was made. Then Alice needs to verify this particular signed will which she has made, but she could have misplaced the certificate or she may no longer be alive after a span of 30 years. In such a cases, archival facility would be of great help to retrieve the issued certificates and then verify the will which is signed by Alice. Now moving to the second topic of today's session, it is a discussion on public key infrastructure architectures. Now we know that public key infrastructure includes various entities such as a certificate authority, the hardware, and also it includes services to support the public key digital certificates, and also various policies and procedures are involved in public key infrastructure. Now the question that arises is, what are the various ways in which these components of the infrastructure can be arranged in order to get a architecture? Now over here in the first type of public key infrastructure architecture that we will be discussing, it is having a single certificate authority. Now there is a single certificate authority with multiple users who are communicating with this particular certificate authority to get issuance of certificates. The second architecture is a tree-based or hierarchical PKI architecture. Over here, there will be multiple certificate authorities which will be arranged level-wise so that the users which are at the leaf nodes will be able to access certificates or get certificates from the branch nodes or the root node. Now moving further, we have mesh based public key infrastructure. Now over here there is no particular arrangement of certificate authorities as in single certificate authority and hierarchical or tree based public key infrastructure architecture. Now what happens in case of mesh based PKIs, the certificate authorities are bidirectionally connected and they can communicate with each other in any order. We will explore this in detail in subsequent or next few slides. Now bridge based PKIs, wherein we will deal with two different public key infrastructures which are used within an organization. Now let's look at each one of them in detail. Now this is the first one wherein we have a single certificate authority to which multiple users are connected. Now this certificate authority one is responsible for issuing certificates to all the other users who are connected to it. Now this certificate authority enables any pair of users to communicate with each other securely. Now over here we have arcs which represent the trust relationship. Now let's say we could see an arc from certificate authority 1 to U2. In this diagram we can see from certificate authority 1 to U2. This means that certificate authority vouches for the U2's public key, since the certificate of U2 is provided by certificate authority 1. What it means is the certificate authority takes complete responsibility of the user 2 because it issues a certificate to user 2. Now what is the disadvantage of such an arrangement? This arrangement is highly non-scalable because there is only a single certificate authority that is involved to which all the other users are connected. Now there is a high overhead involved if the users require more trusted certificates. Now what do we mean by more trusted certificates? Now we have seen the various types of certificates in previous session, which are basic certificates and more trusted certificates. In case of more trusted certificates, more background check was performed. Now, if each of the user is connected to certificate authority for a longer duration for their background check, in that case, this certificate authority will not be able to cater other users. Hence, this architecture fails. Moving on to the next architecture, which is trying to overcome the disadvantage of the first architecture, is hierarchical based PKI architecture. In hierarchical based PKI architecture, it's all the certificate authorities and the users are represented or arranged in the form of a tree. Now over here, this architecture is also referred to as tree based PKI architecture. Now we can see that the certificate authority 1 is in turn connected to certificate authority 2, certificate authority 3, certificate authority 4. The certificate authority 2 is in turn connected to CA5 and then user 1. This certificate authority 5 is in turn connected to user 2 and user 3. The rest is understandable. Now over here, in this tree of CAs, CA1 issues certificate to CA2, CA3 and CA4. CA1 issues certificate to CA2, CA3 and CA4. Now CA2 will in turn issue certificate to CA5 and user 1. Now CA5 is responsible for issuing certificate to user 2 and user 3. This is the arrangement. That is, a node at higher level is responsible for issuing certificate to nodes at lower level. The root node CA1 is also called as trust anchor. Now every node in the tree will know its root certificate authority's public key. Now what are the advantages associated with such a PKI architecture, which is tree based? Now the first thing is, it is able to overcome the disadvantage associated with single PKI, okay, a PKI which had a single certificate authority. And also, each certificate authority over here has limited certificate authorities which are connected to it, and or it also has limited number of users which are connected to it. So in the previous case of PKI with a single certificate authority, all the users were connected to a single certificate authority. Now let's take up a scenario to try to understand how public key is issued through the certificates. Now suppose U1 is a user who needs U5's public key. Now let's take over here, U1 is here, which is having a root node of CA2, and U5 is having a root node of CA6, or the certificate authority 6. Now let's see how these certificates can be issued to U5. Now before checking on with the description, let's try to understand within this particular diagram. Since U1 or the user 1 does not have direct trust relationship with certificate authority 6. U1 is having direct trust relationship with certificate authority 2, but not with the certificate authority 6. Now what is that that needs to be done over here? This user 5 needs to submit a set or a certificates chain in order to reach this particular U1. Now how does this happen? The certificate signed by certificate authority 1 vouching for certificate authority 3's public key is presented. Now second step is, the certificate signed by CA3 vouching for CA6 public key is presented. So CA1 to CA3, then certificate which is signed by CA3 for CA6, and then CA6 up to CA5. This chain of certificates need to be presented to U1. Okay. U5 has a chain of certificates. Now certificate signed by CA1, now same thing, CA1 vouching for CA3's public key, and then CA3 vouching for CA6 public key, and CA6 vouching for U5's public key. This entire chain of certificates is provided to U1. Now since each node has its public key, its roots public key, so U1 will have its roots public key, that is U1 will have CA2's public key, U5 will have CA6 public key, CA6 will have CA3's public key, CA3 will have CA1's public key. Now once U1 receives the certificate chain, U1 is able to verify the signature on the first certificate using CA1's public key. Now and then the public key on first certificate, the signature in the second certificate, and so on. Now moving on to the third PKI architecture, which is referred to as mesh based PKI. Over here we can see the difference between the previous architectures with the help of a diagram. We can see that CA1, that is Certificate Authority 1, is having user 1, and also it is connected to CA3 and CA2. The CA2 has a connection with CA1, CA4 and CA3. CA3 in turn has connection with CA1, CA2 and CA4. CA3 is having connection with CA5 and CA6 as well. Now CA5 is connected U2 and user 3. Now when you see this arrangement, we can see that there is a bidirectional connection which exists between the certificate authorities. Now in case of a tree-based PKI, bidirectional communication or bidirectional relationship did not exist. Now this is a more dense web of trust, which includes mutually trusting certificate authorities. The mutually trusting certificate authorities are represented with the help of a bidirectional arrow. Now CA1 is trusting CA2, and CA2 in turn is again trusting CA1. So this relationship is represented using a bidirectional arrow. Now there could be multiple paths that exist between two users. Let us try to establish a trust path between user 1 and user 7. Over here, user 1 and user 7. Now what is the path that needs to be taken in order to reach user 7 from user 1? So from user 1 to CA1, then CA3, and then CA4, and then U7. Also, there is another path that exists from user 1 to user 7. That is user 1 to certificate authority 1, 2, 4, and then user 7. Now, what is the advantage of having multiple trust paths between two users? The advantage is more resilience if any of the CAs or the certificate authorities get compromised. There will be an alternate path which could be used. The next architecture or the last architecture for public key infrastructure is the bridge based PKI. Now let us look what happens in this particular diagram. Now over here a PKI for a particular organization is represented within this particular circle. And PKI for organization B is represented using another structure. Now, the PKI of organization A has its own certificate authority, and the PKI of organization B is having its own certificate authority. Now, for this particular organization, CA, or the certificate authority, this one is the trust owner. And for organization B, this certificate authority is the trust owner. But when we are trying to connect these two certificate authorities, we use another certificate authority called as bridge certificate authority. In that case, the certificate authorities to which the bridge certificate authority is connecting, we call them as representative CAs. Now, why only the root of the public key infrastructure is called as the representative CAs? Now, this PKI could be a meshed based PKI or a single CA based PKI, or it could be a tree based PKI. And same with this. There is no need for both the PKIs to be same. Organization A, let's say organization A uses a tree based PKI, that means it has multiple certificate authorities which are arranged in different levels. And let's say the organization B is using a mesh based PKI. In that case, let's consider the root certificate authority to be the representative certificate authority, which is used to connect to the bridge certificate authority. The other certificate authorities are just part of the PKI present within the organization. Moving further, this arrangement is used to secure communications within the organization which try to have organizations which have business partnership. Now, over here, the figure that we have just seen depicts that representative CA1 and representative CA2 have their own PKI. The bridge certificate authority establishes a trust relationship with the representative certificate authorities. The representative certificate authority has a trust path with all the users within its own organization. Now, if the organization uses a tree-based PKI architecture, then the representative certificate authority will act as hierarchical certificate authority, and we call it also as root trust owner or the trust owner. Now, let's have a recap of the various PKI architectures that we have discussed. The first PKI architecture that has been discussed is a PKI with a single certificate authority. The disadvantage associated with this single certificate authority architecture is that it is not scalable, and there is a lot of overhead involved if the users need more trusted certificates. Because the more trusted certificates need more background check as that compared to the basic certificates. The second arrangement of the PKI is a tree-based PKI or the hierarchical PKI. Over here, the various certificate authorities are arranged in the form of a tree. The root node, we call it as trust anchor. And also we know that this representation of tree-based PKI architecture is able to overcome the disadvantage of the first PKI architecture because it is scalable. The third architecture that we have discussed today is the mesh-based PKI architecture. The mesh-based PKI architecture is an advanced form of hierarchical PKI wherein it is more dense web of trust. And there is some sort of mutual trusting certificate authorities that exist. That is, bidirectional arc is used in order to represent the mutual trust. The fourth PKI architecture that we have discussed for today is the bridge-based PKI. In case of bridge-based PKI, we have seen that it is used for securing communication between organizations. Now, if you want to connect two organizations which have entered into a business partnership, in that case, both the organization need not use same public key infrastructure. They could be using different public key infrastructure. Now, these two infrastructures used in various organizations can be combined together with the help of a bridge certificate authority. Now, in this bridge certificate authority, we have seen that the certificate authority which is used to connect to the bridge, we call it as representative certificate authority. Now, the advantage of using this bridge-based PKI is that you are able to connect different types of PKI architectures just by connecting to one of the certificate authorities. Now, a user in one organization is able to connect to the user in another organization through this particular bridge certificate authority in the bridge-based PKI. Now, moving further, we will start our discussion on certificate revocation. Now, in case of X.509 certificates, we have seen that each certificate has a validity. What do we mean by validity of a certificate? The certificate's lifespan is represented using the start date and the end date. Now, if the certificate is stopped even before its end date and in that case we say that the certificate is revoked. After revocation, if this certificate, even though if it has not reached the end date, if we use the certificate, then the transaction stands invalid or inacceptable. Now, the question that arises is, let's first see various scenarios and then see how certificate revocation is handled. Let's take a scenario one. Now, each certificate is issued to a particular certificate subject. The certificate subject is nothing but the owner of this particular certificate. Now, over here, let's say the certificate subject is Prashant. Now, Prashant is issued a certificate which is valid from Jan 1, 2010 to December 31, 2010. This is valid for 1 year. Now, this certificate that is issued to him can be used for exchanging the key and also to authenticate. Now, Prashant quits his job on April 1, 2010. But the validity of the certificate is up to December 31, 2010. But he makes a copy of this particular certificate so that he uses it without permission. Now, if the public key in the key exchange certificate is used by another party to encrypt the session key, in that case, whatever messages are exchanged between both the directions, all these messages exchanged stands invalid. Why? It is not legal to use the public key once the employee has quit the organization. His certificate needs to be revoked. Now, let's take up this second scenario. Here, we can see there is a single chain PKI. There is a single chain PKI. Let's say the private key of this particular certificate authority is compromised. The private key of certificate authority 3 is compromised. An attacker with access to this particular compromised private key could then do the following things. What is that he can do? He can generate a public private key pair called as XY, and then he can create a certificate. This particular fellow who is already compromised can create a certificate containing public key X with the subject's name, then sign this certificate using the compromised private key of the certificate authority. Now the transactions, whatever occurs within this particular scenario, all will be invalid. Let's see how we say they are invalid. Now the attacker created a fictitious entity U dash. Now he is able to forge the signature of original user U by signing with the private key Y. And then he is able to provide the certificate chain from the root to the subject U. Now what does the certificate chain has from certificate authority to U? Now the certificate issued by the certificate authority 1 vouching for CA3 is given. Along with that, the certificate created by the attacker is also given. Now this chain of certificates which is provided, it is giving us a valid path from the certificate authority to the subject U. Using the public key of the certificate authority 1 and this particular certificate chain, the verifier would accept a fraudulent signature. Now the question that arises when we see at both of these scenarios is, based on the scenario 1 wherein Prashant has resigned even before the validity of the certificate expires. In that case, the certificates used by Prashant needs to be revoked. Now we need to devise a mechanism in which we are able to revoke the certificate when the employee leaves the organization. And the second scenario, which is telling us about a certificate authority which is getting compromised, in that case any certificate which is issued by this certificate authority, that is CA3 in this particular case, all the certificates which are issued by it should stand invalid if it gets compromised. And also when a trust path is established, this trust path or the certificate chain should not contain the certificate authority which gets compromised. Now let us see how we can handle these certificate revocation scenarios. Now the first solution to certificate revocation is with the help of what we call as online certificate status protocol. Now we use an online facility which will provide us with the status of the digital certificates that are issued. Now this online facility is able to say whether a particular certificate associated to an user is still valid or it is revoked or invalid. Now this protocol is also called as online certificate status protocol. Now when you are able to store the status of all the digital certificates, this will nullify the principal advantage as to why we use the digital certificates. The second method of handling certificate revocation is with the help of what we call as certificate revocation list. Now these certificate revocation lists are distributed to the users so that they are aware whether they should use a particular certificate or not. Now the question is, what is the frequency at which this CRL should be distributed? If this particular certificate revocation list are distributed very frequently or frequently, in that case they consume lot of bandwidth. Now, if these certificate revocation list, which is generated, is distributed infrequently among all the users connected to the certificate authorities, in that case, the revocation list may not reach in time and many other transactions could have occurred. Now, there should be some ideal situation or ideal solution or the timing which is used to distribute these CRLs to the users. Now, the third solution provided over here in order to handle certificate revocation is using TTP. Now, before seeing this, let us see what exactly solution 1 and 2 are conveying. In solution 1 and 2, the validity of a certificate is checked by the verifier. Now, we need a system in which a signer and TTP together need to generate a signature. Now, the third scheme was proposed by Bonnet. Here, both the signer and the trusted third party will have a bit of private key. Both will have a part of private key, but not the complete private key. Each signer's part and the trusted third party's part both will be different and they both will not get to know the other's key part. This private key part, which is present either at the signer or the trusted third party, cannot be used on their own to sign a certificate. Now, having understood this prerequisite, let us see how a document is signed by both signer and a trusted third party. The signer contacts the TTP. Now, once this TTP is contacted, he first checks if the signer certificate is still valid. Now, if the certificate is still valid, let's assume it is still valid, in that case, TTP will participate in signing. Otherwise, let's say if the certificate is revoked, then the trusted third party will not participate in signing of the certificate. Now, this trusted third party can also store the certificates which are revoked. Now, the certificate revocation list information can also be stored on the trusted third party. And also, this trusted third party can act as a timestamp authority. Now, what do we mean by this timestamp authority? Now, let's see what we mean by it. At the time of signing a certificate, this particular TTP will also include the time at which this particular certificate was signed. Next, let's take this scenario or let's take this diagram to understand the effect of time lag between the key compromise and the receipt of certificate revocation information. Now, let's first try to understand this particular diagram in order to understand its actual effect. Over here, the certificate valid start date is 1-1-2010. That is 1st of January 2010 and the second date is April 4th 2010 wherein the signer's key is compromised. That was the day when let's say the employer quit the organization, and 10th of April 2010 the certificate revocation information was received by the other users or the other certificate authorities. Now, December 31st, 2010 is the date when the certificate will actually expire. So, the validity of the certificate is from Jan 1 to December 31st. And we can see that the signer's key is compromised on 1st April, and the information that the signer's key is compromised is received by all others on 10th April. Now, any transactions that occur from 1st April up to 10th April should stand invalid. Now, let's say T1, T2, T3 and T4 are various transactions that have occurred using this particular certificate. Now, if a transaction occurs at T1, it is valid because it is in the valid period. If a transaction occurs between April 1 to April 10th, these two transactions T2 and T3 stand invalid. And also, these two are illegal. Whereas a transaction that occurs after April 4th, it is not accepted. And the users are aware that they should not accept this transaction. But over here, users may accept this transaction because the revocation information has still not received by them. Over here, let's take case 1. The verification occurs at time equal to T3. Now for this, what is happening here? The verifier is simply accepting the signature. Now he is accepting the signature, but little does he know that the signer's key is compromised on April 1st. The next situation is, if verification occurs at time equal to T4. Now over here, if verification occurs at this particular time, verifier rejects the signature because he is aware as he has received the revocation information about the certificate. Now that the signer's key is compromised and still verification, if it occurs at time t equal to t3, in that case verifier is accepting the signature, but he should actually not accept the signature. Now when the signer's key is compromised and if a verification occurs at time equal to T4, verifier rejects the signature. Now we have seen that in the first and the second cases, the subject has signed a document before April 1st. In case 1 and case 2, the subject has signed the document before April 1st, but verification is occurring after April 1st. If the verification is occurring at time equal to T3, still verifier is accepting the signature. If verification of this particular fellow is occurring at time equal to T4, though the signature was generated before April 1, he will have the information that the certificate is revoked and he has to reject. Now in the third case and the fourth case, what is happening is the signature is created during this duration, that is after the signer's key is compromised. So case 1 and 2 deals with generating a signature even before the signer's key is compromised. Now case 3 and 4 are related to generating a signature or creating a signature after the signer's key has been compromised. Now in the third case and the fourth case, we can see that if verification is done at time equal to 3 after the signer's key is compromised, when the signature is generated, in that case the verifier is still accepting the signature because he is unaware that the certificate needs to be revoked. Actually, he should not accept the signature. Now over here, the signature, even though it is generated after the signer's key is compromised, in that case verification is occurring after the certificate revocation information is received. Now in this case, verifier is simply rejecting the signature. Now having understood this two scenarios, wherein in the first case where the employee quit the organization even before, and once he quit the organization, all the certificates which he was using for performing any sort of authentication or key management or encryption needs to be revoked. All those certificates needs to be revoked. And the second situation was the one in which the certificate authority had got compromised. If a certificate authority gets compromised, this certificate authority should not be permitted to issue the certificates, nor it should be a member of any trust path or the certificate chain. So this concludes the session wherein we have seen the various functions of PKI and also the four architectures of public key infrastructure, and seen what we mean by certificate revocation, the scenarios involved, and the three different solutions provided. The first two solutions were given at the verifier's end, and the third solution was given at the signer's end. Thank you. If in case you have any queries, you can revert back over this email, or you can just ping me on this particular phone number or contact number. Thank you.